relying on the Holy Spirit. Amen. I thank my pastors for the opportunity to bring the word. Amen. And I appreciate the way they minister and they allow us to use our gifts. Amen. So I just want to give thanks and honor where honor is due. Amen. And let's see where I'm going to start waiting on the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Glory. Well, a lot was already said. I thought pastors were going to preach my message today. But God is moving in the house. That means that we are from the same vein. Amen.
Yes.
And that God is speaking through all of us. He's confirming everything.
Yes. Yes.
I thank him today. Like pastor says, be thankful. And hi to all of you online. I'm going to ignore that for now, you know. But I hope you're blessed today, all of us in the house, and I'm looking forward to what God's going to do in this place today.
Yes. Yes.
I'm just going to pray and ask God, Father, yes, let me get out of the way, Lord Jesus, and I thank you that your Holy Spirit would take over and that you would be glorified in this place today. You would,
yes,
be honored.
Yes.
And we would just have that seed planted into our heart of your word and what you're saying to us today, Father God, and to take it with us,
yes,
to be a blessing to those around us, Lord.
Yes.
I thank you for the opportunity to bring forth your word,
yes,
and I thank you that you would move through me today in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So, before I bring the message, I'm going to have Malachi play a song for us. It goes along with my message today. So just worship the Lord as you will. And sorry, are you trying to ask me something? Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Malachi, and let's just worship the Lord. If you feel like standing, sitting, kneeling, whatever it is, let's just worship him. Amen.
Don't in my alabaster box. No one knows what you've been through. I can't forget the way life used to be, 'cause I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. And I spend my days, I pour my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I found. Oh, until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of His touch. So now I'm giving back to Him.
Desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet. And stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee, which had bidden him, saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence, and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love the most? Will love him the most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he too, whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house, thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman, hath anointed my feet,
yes,
with ointment.
Yes. Yes.
Wherefore I say unto thee,
yes,
her sins, which are many, are forgiven,
yes,
for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Mm-hmm. And he said unto her, Thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, Who is this that forgiveth sins also? And he said to the woman, Thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your word today. So I want to point out a couple of things. So in the culture of the day, when someone came to your house, you kissed them, and men kissed men on the cheeks. That was their culture. When they came to the house, they anointed their heads with oil. They offered them water to wash their feet because they walked around in sandals. So this was a custom of the day that they were living in, and none of those things were offered to Jesus. But we did see that this Pharisee, he invited him into his home, so he, in a way, honored Jesus as he would invite him to come over, right?
Yeah.
But somehow forgot all the customs that they do there.
Yeah.
So also, something else that stood out to me when it says, and stood at his feet behind him weeping. I never really understood that, but I looked into it, and it's called meat, M-E-A-T. To come and eat. They didn't sit at a table. They would lay on couches like this, their legs up, and they would take the food with this hand and eat it as they're laying on couches and supporting themselves with pillows. So that makes sense to me how she stood behind him and the tears fell on his feet. He wasn't sitting in a chair, because I was like, wait a minute, how is this happening? So that's I'm painting a picture for you to see the customs that they had in those times, in those days. The Pharisee, he honored Jesus by inviting him into the home, but he did not go on with the rest of the customs. So we see the woman, she began to weep, and she just stayed there, and her tears fell on his feet. And she just cried and cried and cried and wept and cried. And we don't really know how she got there. She just showed up. I'm assuming the doors had to be open somehow.
Yeah.
That allowed her just to come in, but some way she was able to make it in there. and just stand there and be a part of that and just cry and cry and kiss his feet. And she just wanted his attention as the master. She just stood at his feet. Yeah. She wiped his feet with her hair. She kissed his feet. She made room for Jesus. She was preparing a place for him to come and to touch her. Her worship increased. She worshiped him with every fiber of her being. There's a place in worship that we can come to and worship with everything that we have, like every, I don't want to say it's emotional, but it's spiritual. You worship in spirit and in truth, but every fiber of your being reacts when you come to a place, a real place of worship in God. It causes you to bow down. It causes you to cry and to laugh. Amen? So, I wanted you to see the worship that this woman had. And she humbled herself, and she came in humility, even though they talked about her and they said things about her and who's this lady and why is she here, and they kept saying things. And there's other in Matthew talks more about the disciples and what they said, but this particular passage shows the Pharisee talking within himself. He didn't really say it out loud, but if you notice, Jesus still answered him, even though he didn't come out and say it. Jesus knew what he was thinking. He knew what he was thinking, and it wasn't a good thing. So he decides to give him a little parable here. You know how Jesus does it. He answers our questions with kind of a question. Gets you to think. And that way, those that shouldn't receive don't know what he's saying, right? So, he talks to Simon and he says, "Seest this woman? She did everything for me that normally you would have done. She came and she did this for me. And she worshiped me and she sat at my feet. And you've done none of these things. You didn't make a room for me. You didn't prepare a place for me." Our worship builds a place for him to come. He comes and inhabits the praises of his people. Amen? There's different ways that people think they're worshiping. You can come in the house with half your brain over here and half your brain over there and just lift your hands or say, "Hallelujah, Jesus, thank you, Lord." And your mind's over there in the other house that you have down the road, and what do I have to do tomorrow, and what is this going to happen, and what's that going to happen, and I don't have enough money, and oh, what about this thing I have to do, and what about that thing I have to do, and oh no. But we have to come into the house in a place of expectancy and receiving from God what he has for us. Amen? Amen. And she came into the house expecting to be forgiven. She wasn't saved. We're saved. We're going to heaven. How much more should we be worshiping him from a place of thankfulness? Or maybe not even thankfulness, maybe expectancy. We're expecting him to do something. What you need is in your worship. Are you worshiping him from a place of regret or unforgiveness? Because you won't get there. If you're holding anger in your heart and bitterness, it didn't look like she came with anger. She came expecting. So what am I trying to say to you? I'm trying to say, come into the house expecting God to do what you need him to do. But where is that place? That place is in your worship. And we see that in the passage here today, that the place of everything that we need is in our worship, as we worship him in spirit and in truth. He needs us in that place. He's waiting for us to make room for him, to be able to come into that place. And as you come into that place with humility in your heart, no pride about what somebody's going to think. When I was younger, I'd worry about, lift my hand. I don't want to do that. Someone might make fun of me. Or I don't want to say that. Or I don't want to be too loud. Or I don't think I have a good voice. None of that matters. Are you expecting him to do something for you? This is the only way it's going to happen. You can't care. You can't have pride in your heart. You can't say, what if I bow my knee? Then what are they going to think of me? I don't know how many times I've fallen to my knees. And just like that, he's right there. You have to come to a place of surrender in him. Surrender everything to him. And he'll meet you right there. In your place of worship. In your place of communion with him. Amen. See, as a little girl, I grew up in church. My mom was the worship leader. Yeah. Yeah. Well, when I was real little, she wasn't the worship leader, but she was always in the choir. My dad was always playing an instrument by ear. Uh-huh. Later, when I was a teenager, she was the worship leader. So we had to be at church on time, early, right? So I know what worship is. And I guess that's why he's having me bring it to you today. Worship is going to cost you something. If you want him to pour that anointing oil into you, you have to release the anointing oil that's within you. Amen?
Come on.
It said she poured out the box of the perfume that we hear was so expensive and so precious, and that the disciples were so upset about, and that we could have sold that and we could have given it to the poor. But none of them understood what was really happening. If you understand that your worship is precious, it means something. It could mean something for you in particular, It could mean something for your children. It could mean something for your grandchildren. It could mean something as we worship corporately. All these things. Our worship means something. We don't know what's happening spiritually when we come to a place of pure worship to honor His holy name. Because He's worthy, amen? And as He pours in His oil, as we have poured it out, He pours it in. And the anointing that becomes on our life is stronger and stronger. And the fragrance that goes with us is greater and greater. Yeah. And wherever we go, they're going to turn their heads. They're going to say, what is that? What is that smell? What is that fragrance? And they're going to want it. Yes. Yes. Amen. We thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you,
Lord. See, what she was doing was preparing Jesus' body for burial. But the Jews, they couldn't see Him as the Messiah. They couldn't recognize Him as the one. She was just a sinner, and she was the one that He chose to prepare His body for burial. They couldn't see who He really was, but the fragrance that she poured out on Him, it followed Him. And as they whipped Him, they could smell the fragrance, and they wondered, what is that? And on the cross, the fragrance was there. And one of the thieves, he recognized it. And he was saved. And in the tomb, the fragrance was there. On the linens that He left behind. And when they came to the tomb, we don't know who was able to come there and to see that. And maybe they were saved too, because they smelled that fragrance. And they wondered what is this? What is this anointing? What is this I'm feeling? And maybe they ask questions. Yeah. Well, that fragrance can be on us too.
Yeah.
And wherever we go. See, we have to come to a place where we have the real fragrance upon us, okay?
Yeah. Come on.
None of this fake perfume. Come on, ladies, who wants some fake perfume? When I was younger, my grandma, she was into this fake Giorgio perfume, and I remember all these different ones were coming out, and it was cheaper, but it didn't last as long, amen? So, we want the real thing, amen? And how do we get the real thing? We get the real thing by entering into real worship with the Lord. We put everything to side. We put distraction to the side. We put our cares to the side. And we can't just worship once a week when we come in here on Sunday. That ain't gonna work. Our worship is gonna carry us through. And it has to be done daily. You can ask Malachi, he probably gets tired of me in the car. That's all I listen to. I don't listen to secular music. I'm not gonna fill my spirit up with that junk. I only want what he has to give to me. I've come to a place where nothing else matters to me but Jesus. I did want to point out that her sin was evident, and they say she was probably a harlot. There's coming a day when people come into this house to worship at the Master's feet that don't look like you and me. They don't smell good. And maybe they don't look right to you. But they've come because they've been drawn in here by the Spirit. And they're seeking forgiveness for their sin. See, Simon, he stood in the place of judgment. He stood in judgment and he couldn't even see what was happening, what the real, what was really going on spiritually. He couldn't discern what was happening. He missed it. If the church continues to stand in judgment, it's gonna miss it. Simon didn't know. He couldn't see that this was the Messiah because he was standing in a place of judgment. Stood in a place of judgment and he missed everything. He could have been the one to anoint him for his burial. He could have received lots and lots, whatever he needed from Jesus. But he stood in a place of judgment. There was recently a movie called The Jesus Revolution. Been talking about the Jesus People movement and how the hippies came into the church barefooted, dirty, and long hair, and they just had a pure love for Jesus as they came in and they sat on the floor. They didn't care if they had a chair. They just wanted to come in and receive something because they knew what Jesus had for them was greater than anything else they've ever smoked or put in their arms or whatever. And they wanted to come to him just as they were. There's a song, "Come As You Are." So church today, I'm asking us, not to stand in a place of judgment when someone walks in those doors. To come and meet Jesus. Because there are people that are going to come in here that we've never seen or had a chance to minister to, that things are changing in our world. People are changing. You know what I'm talking about. Yes. So are we going to judge them in their sin? Mm-hmm. Or are we going to say, I was somebody like you one time. I did things too. But I can help you get there. I can show you who he is. He can fill that void, that thing you want to fill, that you've been searching for. So as a church, I'm asking us, as a body of Christ, that we would come to a place where we worship God for who he is, not just what he's done. When you understand who he is, you can worship him all day long. Amen?
Amen.
So one more thing I wanted to point out was Jesus finally, as she sat and sat and sat and kissed his feet, and he finally acknowledged her. Yeah. And he says to her, thy faith has saved thee. Go in peace. That was kind of strange to me. As a sinner, she had faith. She wasn't saved. So Jesus had been out in the streets and about the town doing miracles, and she must have been watching as she went over here, and she was hiding behind the wall and maybe just listening a little bit or heard a little something. Smelled the fragrance. And that was the faith, all the faith that she needed to get what she really needed was to be saved, delivered, freed from the lifestyle that she was living. Amen? Amen. So we think sinners, they don't have what it takes to get saved, but somewhere along the line, someone's planted a seed in their heart that has caused faith to grow. That's when we go here and we go there with the fragrance upon us, planting a seed. And God helps it to grow. Amen? So, I don't know the oil that you have in that alabaster box of yours. I don't know what it costs you. But you have some. And he deserves it. And you don't know the cost of the oil that I have. But he does.
Yes.
He knows.
Yes.
And he's waiting for you to pour it out. So let us not judge one another in our worship. Because we don't know what we, each one of us, have been through. So I'm going to have our dear friend Deborah come, and she's going to play some worship music for us. And we're just going to have some time of worship in this place. Where you can just come and pour it out. Today, if you've never poured it out, today is the day to pour it out. The altar's open. If you don't get the opportunity to worship Him, now's the time. I challenge you to worship Him from a place that is not comfortable. A place that isn't comfortable. And as we come and worship Him, He's going to pour that oil into you.
Yes.
And it's going to go with you. So be ready. Be ready. He has a designer fragrance for each one of us. Hallelujah.